Welcome to the PI World interview recorded on the 15th of July 2021. And today I'm delighted to be joined by John Rosier of John's Investment Chronicle. And John will be talking about his portfolio, and you should assume he could be buying or selling any of the stocks that he mentions, and that this is not a recommendation or advice and you should do your own research. John, thanks ever so much for joining us.
It's a pleasure.
So how have you found 2021 to date? What's your performance been like?
Well, in the first half of the year, so up to 30th of June, I was up 12.6%. Actually, in July, I've given back about 1.5% of that. But anyway, I'm quite happy with the first half. It's slightly ahead of the All Share and the FTSE All World Index, which I sort of compare myself on a long-term basis. So yes, can't complain.
And how about your longer-term performance since you started the portfolio?
Okay, well, the long-term performance, I guess, is the thing that's important because, if you look at the chart on the right, there's quite a few times when I've underperformed or gone sideways, and 2016 was a down year. But all I'm looking to do is to build up a tidy sum for future security. So I can't complain. I mean, it's up to 30th of June, it's up 360% since I started in January 12. So that's a 17.5% annualized return. I used to just compare myself against the FTSE All Share Index, which is up 98% over that time, 7.4% annualized. But a couple of years ago, I put in the FTSE All World, just because you're including more of the faster growth areas of the world, like the USA, et cetera, to really make it a little bit more difficult. But so far, nicely ahead of that as well.
Tremendous. Well done. So this year, what have been the main contributors to your 12.5% performance?
I've just sort of picked out the best four. And the first one, SDI Group, which is up 71.5% to the 30th of June. And they've just produced a couple of upbeat trading statements, which have led to a quite substantial increase in forecasts. We're waiting for the actual results for the year ended April 21, and they're out next week. Now, forecasts for April 22 are for 7.1p of earnings, which is 16.5% growth. That puts them on 26.2 times, which it might seem a little expensive, but I think forecasts, hopefully after next Tuesday, may be edged up a bit. But also, this is a buy and build strategy they're carrying out. So one would hope that there will be one or two more deals, and that they will be earnings enhancing and lead to forecast upgrades. Generally, they've bought very well, they've not paid too much, and they seem to have integrated their businesses, the businesses they've bought within the group, that very well indeed. So yes, it's done well, and I'm happy to hold on.
The rating has been going up on that, and I know you top slice a bit towards the end of last year. What was your rationale for that?
Yeah, I mean, that's the dreaded top slice, isn't it? Thinking you can outguess the market. And but on the other hand, look, I also did it back in sort of February last year. And obviously, it had a big drop with COVID and the market coming off. And I added back then. The opportunity to do that hasn't worked this time. But I guess the reason is it's sort of risk control. I'm reasonably disciplined. I have sort of target weightings for each stock in the portfolio. It had got up substantially above my target, so just trim it back a bit. I've sort of learned the lesson, I think, that you should never sell so much that if it keeps going up, you get really annoyed and regret it. So, I don't really regret those sales. I put it into other stocks, and it's all about risk control for me.
And what is your weighting on that one?
At the moment, it's just over 5% of the portfolio.
And what size would you be comfortable with it growing to?
If it was to move up again, up towards 7.5%, then I might trim it back to 5 again. And the thing is, with my portfolio, that no new money is going into it. So I can't just add new stocks and things. If I want to buy something else, I've got to find the money from somewhere else. Now, of course, one should try and sell your losers and put it into new stocks rather than selling winners. But you know, I'm looking at the whole portfolio and the sort of risk I like to have within individual stocks within the whole portfolio.
So what were the other contributors?
So SigmaRoc, that was up 50%. And again, another stock which has produced positive trading updates, which has led to upgrades in earnings. It's actively building its sort of quarrying operations throughout continental Europe, mainly in sort of Benelux. The sort of management here, again, it's a buy and build strategy, but they've done it before. The executive chairman, David Barrett, built up London Concrete from start and then sold it to Holcim. And I think that's probably the end game here, but I don't think anytime soon, maybe in 4 or 5 years or something. But as they make these acquisitions, again, you're getting earnings upgrades. Current forecasts are for this year, December 21, 4.8p of earnings, which is 18.7 times for 28% growth. That still looks reasonable to me. And you see, with that one, I've held off taking any profits. But that one is, you know, it's more like 4% of the portfolio at the moment. And you know, I'd happily let that run on and get a bit bigger.
And you're happy with a buy and build growth strategy, but some people will shy away from that.
Yes, I'm happy with it. As long as, I mean, there's a couple of things. Obviously, it's the price they pay. That's very important. If you overpay, then it might never make sense. And I think both of these companies have been disciplined in terms of the price they pay. That's the first. Then the second is, you know, it is within their sort of sphere of expertise. So, you know, they're not diversifying at all. They're just adding to, you know, sensible companies that make sense fitting in within the group strategy.
And moving on to the other main contributors.
Okay, so the two others, so the top four altogether. So Sylvania Platinum, that's up 38% 30th of June. I mean, it's gone up because platinum group metal prices have been strong. And it's quite a volatile stock in that, you know, this gets sold off. And that, I think, I mean, it's been sold off in the last couple of days and got down to, I think, 101 yesterday. And trying to find out why. And someone said, oh, it's because of the rioting in South Africa. Well, from what I can see, it's not really anywhere near where Sylvania operates. But whether that's a reason to sell or not, I don't know. But it must be a market maker's dream, this stock, given the sort of volatility in it and people selling, you know, on down days. And Michael Taylor, who I think is at Shifting Shares on Twitter, he writes in the Investors Chronicle, and he wrote some months back about how he loves Sylvania Platinum for trading. So perhaps I should trade it a bit, but I firmly believe it is worth a lot more than it currently is. Liberum have put out a note recently saying it's only on 4x 2021 earnings and a yield of 5.5%. Again, it's generating loads of cash. We'll find out how much before the end of the month when they come out with their Q4s, where they'll show the cash at the 30th of June. We might have to wait for the dividend announcement, I think, till actual results in September. But you know, I think the news flow is still going to be good from them.
And do you keep an eye on the platinum prices for that one? Is there a threshold below which you wouldn't be happy to hold?
Well, I do, and that, I mean, but you know, the spot price bounces up and down, and yes, it's off from the top. But really, what you've got to look at is the average price in a 6-month period compared to a year ago, because that's you know what they'll be selling at and the cash they'll be generating. So I tend not to worry about these sort of short-term moves in the platinum price. Obviously, you know, if it really broke down lower, then I've sort of got it wrong having you know a decent weighting in the stock, because that would hit it if it moved permanently back. But you know, it would have to halve in price, I think, to really worry me.
And what's your weighting in that one?
At the moment, I'm around 6% in that. So that was a sort of 5% target, but it's moved up with performance. But I've not taken any profit.
And what risk rating do you give that one?
So that's a medium risk, high reward, which is the 5%. So the high reward is because I think, you know, the share price is significantly undervaluing the company. Medium risk is because not, you know, the balance sheet's great and everything, but because it is exposed to a you know, to a commodity price, which, yeah, with all the best will in the world, one can't be definite about. Mm.
And the other main contributor to your performance?
K3 Capital, which I guess is probably another buy and build, although, you know, it's growing organically very well. So K3 Capital was up 36%. That had three positive trading updates this year, all leading to upgrades. And it made another acquisition last week, raised 10 million through a share placing at a slight premium. And yeah, I think I think K3 looks great value. It's to May 21, we'll get the results in September. It's on about 21.8 times for 40-odd% earnings growth. And then to May 22, it's on about 19 times for 14% growth. Well, I think they'll, well, and also those earnings for May 22 have been upgraded by about 12% over the last month or so. And I think we'll get further upgrades as the coming year progresses.
What were the main detractors to your performance?
Okay, so the this chart, which actually I use ShareSite, so this shows the positives and negative contributors. So of the 12.5% gain in the first half, about 6% of that, half of it, came from the sort of four stocks I've just talked about. Then the rest accounted, you know, positives accounted for the other bit. The biggest detractors there, you can see, were two long-standing positions, Biotech Growth and Baillie Gifford Shin Nippon, and then Syncona and Bioventics. And together, they knocked about 2% off the performance. I mean, all things being equal, had I not had positions in those, then I'd have been up 14.5%. But then, of course, it depends where that money would have, what stocks that money would have been in. Maybe it would have been better or worse. Those are the main detractors. I sold Syncona in May because basically I have a new idea, which I'll talk about later, and I needed to raise the money from somewhere. I mean, that had been in there for about 3 years. I sold it. I didn't make any money out of it. I didn't lose any money out of it. I think it's a great story. And I think on a 5-year basis, you'll probably make some great money out of Syncona. But I just felt that over the next 6 months or so, I could use the money better elsewhere. So I got impatient with it and found a better idea. We'll see if that works. In the past, when I've got impatient with stocks, they then start to go up. But we'll see.
Has it moved up since?
No, not really. No, it's just gone sideways, done nothing.
And what about the other three? Are you happy to keep holding those?
Yes, I am. I mean, Biotech Growth and Baillie Gifford Shin Nippon, I've held since 2012, and they've been fantastic contributors to the performance. I mean, they go through periods where, you know, they maybe move sideways a bit, but I, you know, I think there's a case for sticking with them. I mean, I'll talk later about the themes I'm backing within the portfolio, but I think, you know, biotech and healthcare has still got a long, long way to go. And then on Bioventics, Bioventics, again, that's been in since 2014, major contributor, high quality stock, you know, massive returns on capital, up 90%, generates loads of cash. And I just think that it's come off. It's now, on my projections, probably on around a 4% dividend yield for the year just finished in June, taking into account special dividends, etc. But we'll have to wait till October to find out whether I'm right. It's just not been popular this year. I mean, I think people are waiting to see how its new high sensitive troponin test is for heart attacks, because that's a great hope for it over the next few years. And also, the people have been buying value, so a highly valued growth stock that hasn't been at the front of people's mind. But I think its time will come again over the next 6 months or so.
So your learning is patience with those ones, really.
Well, I think so. With a stock where I'm really confident about the management and the business, etc., it's I think easier to be patient. So the ones last year, Tremor International, I mean, what a terrible sell that was. But that sort of life, I mean, I regret selling it, but I obviously, know why I sold it and just got it wrong.
And in December, your pick was De La Rue. Do you want to give us an update on how you're feeling about De La Rue?
Okay, so De La Rue, that's what I said about it then, that good management, Clive Vacher as the CEO, turning around the business, authentication, winning new contracts, had a pretty strong order book, and those were the valuations then, and that's why I picked that. I hate picking a top pick, because look, out of all the stocks in the portfolio, so out of my 21 positions, that I think came 10th. It was up, 10.5% in the first 6 months of the year. So, it was 10th. So I should have picked any one of nine others in the portfolio, and I'd have got a happier story to tell. But anyway, it was up 10.2% in H1. Good management. Delivering the turnaround, they're doing everything as expected. The results to March came in slightly ahead of forecasts. Earnings per share were up 32%. It's put in annual cost savings of 36 million, and I think there's a bit more to come there as well. And the valuation still looks attractive, but the main problem or main concerns, which may be putting people off or why it is so cheap, is the pension deficit. That's costing them quite a lot of money. So in the years up till March 23, they're having to put £15 million per annum into it. And then from 23 to 29, that jumps to £24.5 million per annum. So people are looking at that. But I mean, certainly the sort of forecasts I've seen show that it moves cash flow positive in the year to March 23 and in the years after that. And debt will be coming down, and they're planning to start paying a dividend. So, I think that the payments they've got to make are well within their plan, and they'll be able to meet those. But if those payments were to change and they'd have to make higher payments, then of course that could change things a bit. So that's probably part of the reason it's on such a sort of, to me, attractive valuation. Then the other is that Crystal Amber, who've had a stake in this for some time, it looks like they do have to, in November, have a continuation vote as to whether the trust fund continues as it is, and they need 75% shareholders to support them on that. And at the moment, they've got a hedge fund out of the US called Sabot Capital, who own more than 25% of Crystal Amber, and they have basically said they're going to vote against it. And that's going to be in November. So Crystal Amber are going to have to come up with some plans with shareholders of either winding it up and giving cash back, or others that hopefully they can Sabot Capital will back. Now, they've had over 14% of De La Rue. They've actually recently just reduced that to 12.9%. And I think that's because of this situation rather than them losing confidence in De La Rue. The other thing is Jupiter increased their stake up to, went from virtually zero to 5%. So I think they took some of that Crystal Amber position. But this is a worry for some in that it's sort of overhanging. Now, the ideal situation would be if one of its competitors decided this would be a good way of getting a decent stake in Deliveroo if they wanted to launch a takeover. I've seen that written in some of the papers. Whether that'll happen or not, I don't know. But you know, if it was dribbled out into the market, then you know that could cause you know, some more weakness in the share price. Mm-hmm. But my feeling is you've got to look through this, because I think the valuation is attractive, and in the end, value will out.
So I'm a little bit confused, because the earnings figures on both Stockopedia and ShareScope look as though they are going backwards rather than forwards. That must be adjustments. Can you explain a little bit?
Yes. So I think that both Stockopedia and ShareScope, they're using sort of unadjusted figures. So if you look at ShareScope for the year to that's just finished, March 21, I think they've got 45.9p of earnings in there. Now, that doesn't really make sense to me, because the share price has dropped from £5.50 a few years back down to 50p at one stage last year. So it was re-rated from 10 times to 1 times. Doesn't quite make sense. And also, I think the Stockopedia figure for March 21 was 19p. So it really depends what adjustments you make. Now, the two broker's notes that I've seen basically are looking at the underlying earnings, and those are the forecasts that I've used here. And I think when you're looking at you know, a recovery stock, you know, there are going to be costs. I mean, for instance, they had to close their the passport business after it lost the contract for the UK passports, and so there would have been costs involved with that. And I mean, to me, again, with a turnaround story, what you've got to look at is the balance sheet and the cash flow. And the cash flow, you know, they've sorted out the balance sheet, A, through sort of improving cash flow, but also they did the share placing earlier this year, end of last year. And also, you know, if you look at the forecast for cash flow going forward from the existing businesses, which are growing now, then you know, I think that's the important thing to look at. I mean, I've got to 8.5 times from March 23 there. The two brokers I see are forecasting to the following year as well, March 24, which I think actually then tie in with the ShareScope forecast, and it puts it on about 7.5 times to March 24. And then with the dividends, I think the yield's going to be March 23, probably about 2%, and then rising to over 3% the following year. So it's complicated, I think, with a turnaround and with lots of moving parts. But what I'm looking at here is sort of underlying performance of the business and how that is improving.
Tremendous. Thank you very much for that. So looking at your portfolio as a whole, what are you most bullish about for the next 6 months?
So most excited about, that's a very difficult question, because so back in December, I chose Deliveroo, and I could have chosen any one of 9 other stocks in the portfolio, and they'd have done better. But I'm happy with the ones I already talked about. I think they can go further. And then 3 stocks that I'll mention now: Lundin Energy, that's Swedish listed, that's just growing its production at a tremendous rate at the moment. And that's really down to the Johan Sverdrup field, which is one of the biggest oil finds in you know, recent decades, certainly in the North Sea, a real whale of a field. And that started producing in, I think, October 19. It was forecast that it would produce by the middle of this year around 425,000 barrels of oil a day. It's actually come in nearer to 550,000. And with further development, they're talking about sort of off in 2023-4, that going up to 750,000 barrels of oil per day. Lundin owned 20% of this field. But what it does mean is that, and especially with the rising oil price, they're just getting huge cash flow from this business. They put up the dividend last year the dividend was $1 per share. They've increased that in April for this year to $1.80. Now, we've got Q2s at the end of the month, 28th of July. I'm not really expecting them to make any change to the dividend then. I mean, they could do, but I think you'll certainly see great, you know, cash flow come through, which I think bodes well for another decent increase in the dividend next year. So it's on a yield. I mean, if you're a Swedish investor, you're getting a yield of nearly 5%. UK investors, if they're invested in a SIPP or ISA in this, cannot reclaim withholding tax of 30%. But you know, I prefer to look at it that overseas investors and Swedish investors, they'll be valuing it, and I think with further dividend growth, they'll buy more, and you'll make good capital appreciation out of it.
And you don't worry that oil's out of favour at the moment?
Well, I think that's why there's an opportunity in these stocks. And I know, big oil is sort of moving out of exploring for more oil, et cetera. And, however quick we move to, electric cars, et cetera, and replacing sort of carbon-based fuel, oil and gas are going to have a huge role to play for many years to come. And I think there's a good few years yet before oil demand peaks. And in the meantime, there's no sort of investment or very little investment in new fields. So I think you could easily have a good big spike in the oil price. Hopefully these companies will benefit hugely from that. And also, morally, can you invest in oil companies? Well, I think you can. I don't think it's quite the same as tobacco, which sort of killed people. With oil companies, much of the progress of the last 100 years around the world and bringing people out of poverty, etc., has been due to the availability of cheap energy. They've got their part to play for a few years to come, I think.
And it's Swedish listed. How much do you invest in overseas stocks? I mean, Sweden isn't a particularly known exchange. So what's the attraction?
The attraction is the company.
But do you look at global markets, I suppose, is what I'm asking?
Not really, because I play anything overseas through investment trusts. So, that's my way of gaining exposure to overseas markets.
So why is this the exception?
This is the exception because I think it is an exceptional company. I think, if you go on the website and just look at the growth in production that's coming through, then, the cash flow that this is going to generate is huge. And obviously the margins, because they're not having to put any more cost into this, into these two fields, or very little cost, the margin is going up as well as production goes up, and also the oil price. And then the other thing is, carbon-free oil. I know that doesn't quite make sense, but actually they earlier this year actually sold the first sort of certificated barrel of oil that was didn't use any carbon in terms of its production. So the Johan Sverdrup field is fed with electric cables from Norway, using wind power and hydropower. So basically the production is green. So that's got to be better than buying some production that isn't green, I think.
And your next pick?
Well, Serica Energy, you can see on the chart, it seems to have broken out nicely. That's one where I have been patient. It's had some good news in the last few weeks with two development wells that it's drilled coming up trumps with good flow rates. So there's been sort of 15% increase to production expectations for this year. I mean, they come online this quarter and next. The other positive news for them is they bought three fields off BP and Total 3 years ago. Part of that deal was that their share of the cash flow from them, or their net share of the cash flow, would build up, and it moves up to 100% next year from 60% this year. So there's going to be very, it's got cash on the balance sheet already. I think Jefferies put a note out the other day. I mean, they, for what it's worth, they had a target price of 190p. But what they were saying was that 190p, it would still be valued at an enterprise value to EBITDA of less than 2.5 times. So they paid a dividend last year of 3p, this year of 3.5. I think with the cash flow coming through, you're going to see some really good dividend increases from us in the next few years.
So why is it so cheap?
For the reason I think you came up with earlier on, that basically the public markets don't like holding energy stocks. But I think in the end, the dividends and yield on this will be attractive to investors, and it is starting to perform. And so I think, although some may not want to hold it, I think others will see the opportunity.
Isn't it difficult when institutions are running for the exit, whether it's a company or whether it's a sector, as people are with that ESG focus at the moment? Doesn't it become a value trap?
I think, yes, they are running for the exit. I think they've done quite a lot of the running. That's why a lot of these stocks were looking so attractive. And I just think you're going to be in a situation where, others will step in. So if you've got the sort of public markets don't want to invest in these companies that are generating lots of cash and a good value, going to give you a good return on your equity, then I think private equity will. Things. It's interesting, Kistos, which came to the market a few months back, they're doing deals and things. So, I think there's deals to be done, but I think private equity will get involved.
Interesting.
And at the end of the day, I think, the dividend yields on these are going to grow and grow, and they can prove attractive investments, even if they maybe don't get to the sort of premium valuation you'd hope they would get to.
And do you have any other picks, perhaps not in the oil sector?
Okay, yes. Well, they're my only two energy stocks. So, and maybe in 3 years' time they won't be there because we'll move on to the next stage. But I think they are present a particularly good opportunity at the moment. But a stock I bought recently, and at the moment it is still only 2.5% of the portfolio, so I have it as high risk, high reward, is Supreme. Now I don't think it really is high risk. It's just I don't know it maybe well enough, but I'm hoping after the results next week that maybe I can change the risk rating to medium on it. I mean, certainly in terms of the quality of the business, it generates a high return on capital. And basically what it does, it distributes in, four main areas. So batteries, sports nutrition, vaping, lighting. And certainly the first three of those are all sort of fast growing areas, or sports nutrition and vaping are. I mean, they were up 38% revenue growth in the trading update for the year end March. Batteries, they have about 20% of the UK market. So if you go to your corner shop and buy some batteries, it most likely would have been distributed by them. And if you're into vaping, I'm not, but if you are, again, there's a good chance as you go into a small independent that they have actually distributed to them. And they also have their own brand, so 88 Vape, which they manufacture, so they get extra good margins on that. And then in sports nutrition, that's a fast and health sort of nutrition, that fast growing area. And again, they own some of their own brands and getting good margins through that. I mean, the founder and CEO owns 56% of the business. And then I think it's got quite a good sort of institutional backing with Canaccord at 5.9 and BlackRock and Slater, Premier Miton. In fact, Gervais Williams sort of speaks about it in a recent video. So, it's a stock which I think looks good value. It's on sort of 17.7 times for March 21, i.e. the year's just ended. So we'll find out whether that's correct next week. And that's for 21% growth. Then to March 22, the forecast of 15.2 times earnings for 16% growth. So I think that looks pretty good anyway. But, you know, they're making small acquisitions and infills, etc. And, you know, hopefully that, you know, there'll be earnings upgrades over the next year as well. So, you know, it's one I've just introduced to the portfolio, but I hope it'll be there for some time and one that I'll have confidence to add to. Maybe after next week.
It's up 25% since IPO. What did you get in at?
Just see on the chart. I think it was 190p around that level. But, you know, it looked good value at that price. So I was happy to add it to the portfolio.
And you don't mind IPOs. You're in favour of buying IPOs.
Well, I think buying IPOs at, you know, at time of IPO is often quite risky. You know, they can go to a premium and then you can be left high and dry. But I think, you know, after a few months and you can see how the business is going, the trading updates, etc., then that gave me a bit more confidence. And also I like the valuation. You know, I think that's on my side. So, yeah, I mean, IPOs I'm generally wary of. But I think in this case, I didn't buy it at the start. Getting to know it, it's part of the reason why I have it high risk to start with. But given the strength of the balance sheets, etc., I mean, it should really be medium risk. But I need to get to know it a bit better.
And last July, I believe you started a funds portfolio. How's that done?
I did. And the reason for starting that was occasionally people would leave John's Investment Chronicle. And often the reason was because they didn't really have the time or inclination to pick sort of individual stocks and we're going to move to an all funds thing. So I thought it'd be a good idea to sort of come up with a funds portfolio that did just invest in funds. So this actually is my wife's SIP. I mean, it follows this exactly. The first year was great. I mean, it's up 34.5% against the All Share, which was up 21.5%, and the All World 25%. So I don't think I'll replicate that every year, but it was a nice start.
And how was that against the performance of your own stocks portfolio?
So the longer, you know, the JIC portfolio, the stocks one, which has been going on, nearly 10 years now, over the exact same period, that was up 37.5%. So a few percent more, which I suppose is good news. It should be, I guess, taking extra risk picking stocks. But, you know, who knows? I mean, if in 5 years' time I've done a lot better with the funds portfolio, then I'll work out I'm a better picker of funds maybe than stocks. So we'll wait and see how it turns out.
What were the top picks there?
So over the, I mean, it was a sort of proverbial tale of two halves, I guess. You can see from the chart that certainly, you know, of that 34.5%, about 20-odd% of it came in the first 6 months, and the other sort of 10 and a bit came in the last six. So it's got a more of a growth orientation, you know, to the sort of funds I've invested in. So certainly 3 or 4 months this year, when people are focusing more on value, some of its growth ones were sold off, and I, you know, don't have so much value in there. I mean, I've got the Premier Miton UK equity, which has performed well since I bought that in January. But over the year as a whole, BlackRock Throgmorton was up 65%. Chelverton UK Equity Growth Fund, so that's not an investment trust, that's an open-end investment company, that was up 63%. And the performance of the manager there is just second to none. If you look back at the last 5 years in terms of the, you know, the stocks he's picked and how he's done against the peer group. And then BlackRock World Mining was up 62%. And then if you look at the bottom, even the worst, you know, they were all up. So they all contributed over the 12 months.
So what's your turnover there on funds coming in and out of that portfolio?
It's very, very low. And that was the idea of it. It was to really pick funds, stick with them, and then sort of review it once a year. So I've just done that in the last couple of weeks. And I've kept with the same names, but sort of rebalanced it a bit. So things like Chelverton UK Equity Growth that had grown to a very big position, and BlackRock World Mining, I just trimmed back a bit and then added to Biotech Growth and Worldwide Healthcare and Baillie Gifford Shin Nippon. So just rebalancing it because, you know, on a 12-month view, it could just be that the three worst ones end up near the top. So it just seemed to make sense to me, especially as I'm still happy to hold those on a long-term view.
So when we spoke to you back last year, right in the middle of COVID when it had first struck, you were absolutely brilliant in calling the markets. So where are we at now? How do you feel about inflation? How do you feel about where we're at with the markets? What's your overall view for going forward?
Okay. Brilliant or lucky, but anyway. I sort of was pretty fully invested, yes, at the beginning of April last year, and that worked out very well over the year. That, you know, it's always something to worry about. That's the first thing. And at the moment, the market is worried about inflation. And is it transitory? And just because we're coming out of COVID, or is it something that's going to be more lasting and more concerning? And I don't know the answer to that. And you listen to all the commentators, none of them know the answers. They've all got views, but we'll have to wait and see. But I mean, this chart here shows the US Treasury 10-year yield. And certainly back in March, it was sort of heading upwards. And I think people were thinking it would go to 2%. I thought it would, which just shows, again, what a mockery markets can make of one's views. But it's come back, and even with higher inflation figures, it's down at, you know, towards 1.3%. And I don't know where that'll be in a year's time. Again, I'll have a guess. I think it'll go back up towards 2%. So I sort of look at it and think I'd rather be in equities than bonds. I think the sort of reopening trade is still on. I think valuation, certainly of UK and European markets, don't look so bad. And I think central banks are, you know, if they're going to take any risk, they're going to take risk towards letting inflation run a bit. And, you know, everyone's saying, what's the Bank of England going to do? But back in 2011, inflation peaked in September at 5.2%. And we're getting excited about 2.5%. And in fact, throughout 2011, it was over 4%, I think, the whole time. And yet the Bank of England did very little. So, you know, they may make the odd noises and things, but I think they're going to let it run. And governments want some inflation to get rid of the debt that they've built up over the last, well, not just last year, but the last decade. I do think one needs to be more circumspect in terms of what one buys, and the valuation is really important. We've gone through a bit of a phase where it was just buy anything. The economy is recovering, so doesn't really matter about the valuation. If it's cyclical, get into it. I think now you've really got to be certain about the way the company performs and what you're paying for it. So, you know, there's a lot of sort of leisure areas I'd be slightly wary of, because, and, you know, airlines and things like that, demand will increase and number of people flying will obviously increase, but how long will it take actually to get back to the peak levels we saw, and what are you paying for it, and what are the balance sheets like? So I think one's got to be a bit more wary now as to what one buys. You can't just buy any old recovery stock. And then the themes that I like within, you know, and I'm still backing, and I guess the greening or electrification of energy use. And I'm playing that mainly through commodities, through metals that will be involved in that. And I think copper's obviously the number one in terms of its use in electric cars and wind turbines and everything else. And then also other metals like nickel and cobalt, in terms of being used in battery technology. And so I think a lot of the metals, you know, people are talking about another super cycle. We've had a great run in it all. It's now coming off a bit because people are saying, oh, what's growth going to do, etc. But I think over the next 3, 4, 5 years, these things are just going to demand is basically going to overtake supply. Because there hasn't been enough investment over the last 10 years into, you know, new supply, into new mines, etc. So I still think it's a good place to be. And then healthcare and biotech, I've held those for, well, in big exposure in both portfolios. Well, in the JIC portfolio since 2012, but also in the funds portfolio. And, you know, I just see we're going through an era of huge innovation and progress on the front through things like gene therapy. And you read about it all the time. It's sort of diseases being treated, which, you know, in the past, there was no hope, really. So, yeah, those are two which I'm still backing as themes I like, you know, not just for the next six months, but for the next 2, 3, 4, 5 years.
Tremendous. John, thank you very much indeed for a superb interview. Tell our listeners where they can find you and find out more about John's Investment Chronicle.
Well, I launched a new website in April. The other one was a bit clunky. And the great thing about this is it's not so difficult. It's just jicuk.com. What I do on there is I show both portfolios. So the funds portfolio is basically my wife's SIP, and the JIC portfolio is my SIP and my ISAs. And whenever I make a change, which, I mean, this isn't a day trading thing, it's sort of much more about long-term investment. I've probably only done about 7 or 8 trades this year in total. I did none in June, and I think none in March and April. So, but whenever I do trade, I let people know what I've done, why I've done it. So I'm essentially, my members are my auditors, and the records there is all there on the website. So thank you very much.
Many thanks indeed. And to all our listeners, many thanks for joining us today. You can find over 100 investor interviews like this at piworld.co.uk/PIwisdom as a video or as a podcast. And do subscribe to receive a notification of new videos published, and you'll get no spam. And please motivate us to keep producing these interviews by liking it, retweeting it, or commenting on the content. It means a lot to us. Many thanks for listening, and stay well.